Da, te auzim, te auzim. Sau eu te aud, nu știu acum. Once again, can you hear me right?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, thank you.
But should I introduce myself, or you will introduce us? Okay, so...
Yes, exactly, I will introduce you. Just like the last time, I will have an introduction for a couple of minutes, 3 minutes. At the end, I will say your names and positions, and then I will give the floor to Mr. Yula Father to start.
Hi, do you hear me? Yes. Actually, my camera is working, so you should see me. One moment, I will check it. Yeah, do you hear me? Okay. Thank you.
You mean 30 seconds?
So in 30 seconds, yeah. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome, and thank you all for accepting the invitation from OTP Bank for this macroeconomic webinar on global and local markets. This is already the third edition of this event this year. We've come a long way. My name is Alexandru Angel, and once again, I will present this event, which will last for about 1 hour. So, today, during this webinar, we will approach the current economic status and context, and also future prospects by sharing with you important macroeconomic insights, and also by looking at how recent market and policy shifts have impacted the overall economy. Before we begin, I have a few housekeeping rules to tell you about. So today's session is being recorded. All speeches and presentations today will be held in English. And of course, translation is being provided. For Romanian, please press the translation button on the screen. Also, please keep your microphones on mute during the event and your cameras on. If you have any questions for the presenters, of course, please use the chat feature and post the questions right in there. So at the end, if the presenters, they will answer during the Q&A sessions. Also, please mention which presenter you are addressing the questions to. Going further, let me introduce the keynote speakers. They're here with us are Gyula Fater, CEO of OTP Bank Romania, Gergely Tardoș, Chief Economist, Head of OTP Bank's Research Center, and Mihai Kovac, Economic Advisor at OTP Bank's Research Center. Now, let's please welcome our first presenter, Gyula Fater, CEO of OTP Bank Romania. Sir, you have the floor.
Thank you, Alex, for the introduction. Dear partners, thank you for accepting the invitation to our macroeconomic webinar. With this quarterly macroeconomic analysis and with our collaboration, we want to provide you with an accurate data and to continue to be a relevant source of information for you. In Romania, OTP Bank has a solid position and is far ahead in the second part of the 5-year growth program. We have accomplished all our business milestones so far, and now we are focusing on consolidating the growth, defining the newly improved products and services that we offer, and developing our teams available for you, for our customers. We have invested constantly in digitalization and in our operational resilience. And we also believe in human interaction, probably even more than ever. We have now almost traveled through the entire uncertain year with enough upsides and downsides. Unfortunately, more downsides than upsides. It's enough for a decade. And now it's time to be even more aware of how all these influences will affect us in the future. Good news, fortunately, Romania is in a relatively good situation with all the inflows of EU funds and subsidies. And this is a fact that we are less dependent from external energy sources than the neighboring countries. It might make the difference in the winter ahead, and that's the good news. We know that there is still uncertainty, but hopefully inflation is now close to the top, which means that soon the interest rates will be reaching their maximum, which it's an opportunity for all of us. We're here to follow these and to provide suitable solutions for you. And we believe that we have the tools to transform these developments, these threats into opportunities for you. Having followed evolutions and possible trends, it might be high time for you also to start thinking about investments and evaluate together how to make the most of all these opportunities. Today, during this third event, as part of our quarterly series across the year, we will share valuable macroeconomic insights with you to help you to stay on the top of the wave. My colleagues have prepared all the necessary details for you. And of course, we all will be available after the session for a Q&A. Thank you and enjoy the rest. And I'm forwarding it to Gergely, who starts with the macroeconomic review.
Good afternoon to everyone. I'm Gergely Tardoș, and I will start the presentation with the Romanian summary and the global outlook. The main message is here that even in these challenging times, Romania could be labeled as lucky. because as Gyula mentioned, it's very important that you will receive the EU funds, and it's very, very important that Romania, because of large own production of gas, it's much less dependent on external energy, and that gives the country a clear advantage against some other regional competitors. Here you can see on the table our main figures, and I think the most important thing is that while Romania will slow down next year, growth will remain clearly in the positive territory. This slowdown is caused by higher energy prices, of course, which is a very big challenge to every company and every household and every government in Europe. And also because this energy price shock results in a sharp slowdown in the Eurozone economy, which could stagnate next year. And even slight recession is within the cards in the Eurozone. And this will be a drag on exports. Regarding inflation, it can be around the top in Romania, according to our estimations. And looking ahead, it will gradually moderate, albeit this will be a slow process. In our view, the central bank will deliver another round of tightening, and the base rate could reach 7% by November, and we expect the rate cuts to be started next year. The twin deficit situation is also, we remain with Romania, and we think that this is a risk factor. However, looking ahead, we expect some gradual improvement regarding the deficit situation. In the previous macro updates, we always told that loan growth, which was really strong, will gradually moderate looking ahead because of weaker growth outlook and because of higher interest rates. And actually, the first signs that this process has been already started, that's right now can be captured, especially in the household loan segment. On the next slide, you can see what's happening with GDP growth in the large economies in the world. So far, growth rates have started to slow down. It's very close to zero in China. Annual growth rates fell to around 2% in the United States. European performance looks to be better because in the second quarter, year-on-year growth still exceeded 4% due to the positive effect of the reopening after the pandemics. But looking ahead, the situation is much more grim because further slowdown is in the pipeline. This slowdown in economic activity can be captured in the evolution of global commodity prices, which rose to very high level after the reopening and after the war started in Ukraine. Nevertheless, in the recent months, they started to gradually to moderate and to get to lower levels. And this is something which on the middle run could result in some disinflation around the world. On the next slide, you can see the most important commodity prices these days, at least for Europe. And on the upper chart, you can see the prices of European natural gas, which increased to extremely high levels after Russia started to cut back supplies through the Nord Stream pipeline to Europe, because while let's say that in the previous decade the average price of natural gas was around or just below 20 euro per megawatt hour, this price rose to above 300 euro at the peak, and at that moment it was very clear that this will be the most important economic topic in the next few years. What will happen to gas supply and what will happen to gas prices? Because at levels which are nearly 20 times higher as we get used to in the previous many, many years, it's an extremely large economic shock. Luckily, since the peak, prices fell a lot. By now, they are more than 50% lower than they were at the peak. However, this level is still nearly 10 times higher as what was called a usual price level in Europe. And actually, something very similar happened to electricity prices because for a while, marginal electricity production in Europe is provided by gas turbines. This results in a situation that the price of gas also determines the price of electricity in Europe. And this is a very large shock, especially for those economies who are relying a lot on external energy. Because of the supply chain problems during and after the COVID, because of the sharp rise in food and also of energy prices, global inflation rose to very high levels. Actually, even in developed economies, they are reaching 9-10%, or in many economies, they exceed this level. And these levels were not seen in the last four decades. And this is extremely important from an economic point of view, because high inflation erodes real wages, results in demand disruption in every economy of the world. And it's also very important that it forces central banks to hike rates in order to avoid a price wage spiral, which would lead to high inflation for a very long period. On the next slide, you can see how central banks are reacting on high inflation in major economies. Right now, both the Fed and the ECB delivers large interest rate hikes of 75 basis points on every interest rate setting meeting. And at the peak, the base rate in the US would reach 5%. And in the Eurozone, it can reach something like 3% at the peak. And it's very important that risks are still lying on the upside, because if the moderation in inflation will be lower than expected, in that case, central banks could go or should hike rates higher. And this very, very challenging environment results in a situation that, looking ahead, the risk of recession is really high. On this slide, you can see the probability of a recession are based on a poll of Bloomberg among macroeconomic analysts. So here the question looks like, what is your opinion? What is the probability of a recession within 1 year in the Eurozone and in the US? And this probability right now reached 75% in the Eurozone and 50% in the US. And actually, this is very high compared to the normal level of 10%. So the recession risks are on the rise and they are really high. And on the next slide, you can see the GDP growth outlook for major economies. And you can see that for next year, the economic consensus is that the Eurozone will actually stagnate and risks are on the downside. And the US economy, the economy of the US could grow by less than 1% next year, which is well below the historical average. And and this means a really weaker growth outlook than what we had two or three quarters ago, when the consensus suggested that the GDP growth in 2023 could reach something like 2.5% in both of these economies. And finally, about global inflation. With the gradual correction in global commodity prices. And because central banks are doing the tightening and the economies will slow down, inflation is expected to moderate looking ahead. In the US, it's around the peak. In the Eurozone, it could increase in the next few months, but in next year, we should expect inflation to gradually moderate in the large economies. And that is good news because that will help inflation to moderate also in other economies like in Romania. Thank you. And now I would like to give the floor to Mihai, who will tell our main insights on the Romanian economy.
Well, Mihai, before you begin, I would like to remind to our listeners here that they can address questions for each and every one of you. They can post it in the chat section of this webinar. And at the end, we'll address the questions one by one. Thank you, Mihai. You have the floor now.
Thank you very much and welcome everyone at this webinar. So we have been talking about sky-high energy prices and possible recession, but at least stagnation in the euro area. And now our question is that how it could affect the Romanian economy. And basically there are two very big channels that should be highlighted. On the one hand, the weakening activity in the Eurozone means that foreign demand weakens for the export sector in Romania, which means ceteris paribus lower growth in Romania. And the other important point is that the high level of energy prices, increased energy prices, means terms of trade deterioration for Romania. It's a economic jargon. It means that your import prices become higher than your export prices because you import more energy than you export. And these terms of trade deterioration, which leads to a higher current account deficit, it should be adjusted to by domestic actors. So this is a lost income in the economy. Because, you know, what you sell is relatively cheaper compared what you buy and import, if you think about the energy. And domestic actors must pay the higher bill. And it is a question, it's an economic policy question, who, to what extent will pay this bill. It depends, among other things, to what extent the government steps in to help companies and households pay the bill. In this respect, it's also important what is the size of the shock for the economy. And here on the upper right chart, you can see one bar, which is the net oil, gas and electricity import in 2021, which is relatively far away, but let's say this is the starting position for these economies. And it shows that the net import in Romania of these items are on the lower edge, especially compared to some regional countries like Hungary, Bulgaria, Slovakia, Czech Republic. So this means that at least the good news is that Romania, or relative good news, which my colleagues already mentioned, that Romania is somewhat less exposed to this energy price shock than other countries. In the lower table, which has been taken from the IMF Article 4 report, you can see a more detailed assessment of net energy import. And you can see that actually in natural gas, like just above 20%, 23% is import compared to the domestic use. Which is actually very good news because, for example, in Hungary, we have this variable like closer to 90%. And this means that although prices are higher for energy producers, also some income is generated in the economy in Romania, which at least can be used from a budgetary point of view to support other economic actors. So it means that not all the effect of high energy prices means that the income is running out of the country, but some part of the extra effect of high energy prices remains within the country. And still, we think that there are certain sectors, like a quarter of GDP at least, which is very heavily sensitive to the slowdown. These sectors are mainly in industry, for example, mining. You might have followed that there is the aluminium company Arro, which already halted production and sent like close to 2,000 staff for temporary freeze. But also other sectors like transport or the catering sector could be very sensitive to this high energy price situation. If we think about the exact effect of this magnitude for Romania, on this chart you can see that at the roughly the current level of natural gas prices, the current account is expected to be deteriorating because of this effect close to 2% of GDP, which means that if all these higher prices would be at the end of the day pass through to consumers, consumption would fall by 2%. This means that if the government wouldn't step in at all to freeze prices, which is, we know that happened, that they stepped in at the end of the day, and also under the extreme assumptions that all the extra costs are passed through from the company side to consumers. With a natural gas price of 300 euro, this effect is closer to 3%. But again, like I haven't put it on the chart, but these magnitudes are like close to 10-15% for those economies in the Central and Eastern European region, which are the most exposed to net energy imports, like Hungary or Slovakia. So in this respect, in relative terms, Romania still is not in that bad situation because of the relatively big domestic energy production. Moving toward the GDP situation, those of you who have been following these webinars, you might have remembered that we expected a slowdown in economic activity, which slowdown actually occurred in the last quarter, but to a much lower extent than we envisaged earlier. And here on this chart, what you can see is the contribution of different sectors to GDP growth. And here I would highlight at least two or three points. One is that the reason behind let's clear the figures. So the first quarter GDP growth was 6.3%. The second quarter GDP growth was 5.1%, which was just revised slightly downwards today to 5.1 from 5.3. The general point is that these are reasonably strong figures, and especially if we look at the Q-on-Q growth rates, I mean, they are quite high in international comparison. And the reason why, contrary to several analysts' expectations and also our expectation to admit, Romania has performed in the first half of the year very well, is what Gergely already mentioned related to Eurozone. This is the recovery from the COVID crisis and the reopening of the HoReCa or catering sector, which you can see with this yellow bars. It added like 2 percentage points to GDP. At the same time, what is much less clear-cut is this blue bar, which is the effect of information communication sector, which is a relatively small sector. Nevertheless, it added like close to 2% to GDP growth in the first quarter and more than 1.5% in the second. While, there's no clear-cut answer for this, and it's also a bit uncertain how long this could prevail. So this effect, this blue bar from the information communication sector, is even bigger than what we had during the COVID time, when really everyone went to home office and you know, everyone was picking up on this IT equipment and this, the importance of these services increased sharply. What is clear that industry is relatively weak, and for this year's performance, what is also very questionable, that what will happen with agriculture. So far, the accounted effects are relatively neutral for GDP growth, but we know that like around 20-25% of the cereal harvest would be 20-25% weaker than last year. Because of the extreme drought, not just in Romania, but in almost whole Europe, this could have effect a negative effect on GDP. For the third quarter, what we can see, these are some key indicators on the chart up to August or July, depending on the indicator. What is clear that the service sector year-on-year performance is weakening. Actually, some indicator might move to minus. We will see how this will appear in GDP. I wouldn't overemphasize this, but the slowdown is clear after the COVID crisis, and we have some slowdown, although much more minor, in retail sector as well. So we think that economic activity for Q3 is clearly slowing down, and this slowdown will continue in Q4 and Q1. And if we look it in terms of the outlook, and from the not from the sectoral side of GDP, but from the EU side, what we can argue that we expect this year's GDP growth at slightly below 5%. We are aware that there are higher GDP growth projections on the market now, and indeed there can be arguments. Actually, no, our projection is quite close to that of the IMF, which has been just released yesterday. And the reason we are a bit cautious for this year's GDP growth, because this 4.7 means that the Q-on-Q growth rate will sharply slow down in the second half, is the effect of agriculture on activity. And on the final use side, and looking ahead, what also drives down GDP growth is household consumption, which effect starts already the second half of this year, but clearly will develop in full next year, when we expect GDP growth to slow to 2.5%. And afterwards, gradually, there can be some pickup more to around 3-3.5%, which is closer to Romania's potential output performance. So next year's 2.5%, if you compare it to stagnation in the Eurozone, it's not a bad performance, I would say. And apart from the naturally from the slowdown in household consumption, this is also driven by weaker export performance. And naturally, as just it was mentioned before, it is helped by a substantial inflow of EU funds to the economy. Moving toward some details on the labor market, what we can see is that so far up to like July, August, we haven't seen any deterioration in the labor market situation, despite, you know, that you can hear like the problems, especially due to high energy prices rising everywhere. Employment is expanding relatively decently. Unemployment is still declining, and it's a relatively low level. Although I have to admit that we more or less observe this picture in most of the regional economies. And first, we should see a more substantial slowdown in GDP and economic activity before it starts to be felt on the employment. And maybe another reason why we don't see companies adjusting to slowing activity with lower employment is that real wages, on the other hand, are already declining significantly, like 2-3%, which means that wages have not kept up with the increase in inflation. And naturally, this has a negative effect on consumption, and this is what we expect also on the forecast horizon to prevail. Regarding budgetary processes, it was mentioned that one of the key fragilities of the Romanian economy is its twin deficit problem, which is the fact that Romania has a budget and external current account deficit at the same time. So a large reason for the external deficit is the budget deficit. What we can observe recently that after a halt in the first half of the year, end of last year, the fiscal budget balance has started to improve. You can see the cash balance, which we have more updated data with this orange line. By the black line is the ESA quarterly balance, which is like the EU-based deficit, which is assessed based on the commission assessment. And this is something which should be brought below 3% under the excessive deficit procedure that Romania is in. But here the good news that the budget deficit improvement has resumed. It has two reasons in our assessment. One is that revenues are coming fast, partly due to the surprisingly high inflation, but also the better than expected economic activity. And on the other hand, some expenditure cut measures have been adopted, like a 10% freezing of expenditure apart from wages and investment. But despite this improvement in the fiscal deficit, the current account balance continued to deteriorate. Now it's around 8.5% of GDP, the deficit, which is quite high, but we have to admit that we cannot allocate this effect largely to the energy price hike. It has a role, like just we have shown, like around 2% of GDP if it appears in full. But the current account deficit in Romania was already relatively high even before the energy price hike, and it's a very good luck for Romania that it's not a huge net energy importer compared to Hungary or Slovakia, because then we could have observed much higher deficit now, which would increase fragilities. Moving toward the inflation front, the latest data, the September inflation data, was just released today in the morning. It was 15.8% inflation level. We have to admit we expected like 15.4% inflation, which is slightly lower. There were some uncertainty because the effect of the new gas price freeze appeared in the data, and it had a slightly higher effect on gas and electricity prices than we estimated. And the other is we experienced some extra effects compared to our expectations with some goods, retail goods products. But overall, what we observe is like that if we look at the big picture, inflation has been hovering around 15, slightly below 16% for three, four months. And although, you know, we can expect some shocks, for example, from food prices, and I haven't mentioned actually food was also a bit stronger than we foreseen for the September data. Although we can have some surprising effects from food prices still. Given that what Gergely just described, that probably with most commodities we are over the peak, there's a chance that this commodity inflation pressure on companies will decrease. On the other hand, there will be a reappearing of slowing activity on inflation. So looking ahead, we think that inflation is now around or close to peak, and it shouldn't go much higher than this. Actually, in our forecast, from now on, it will start to slowly decline, and then it could decline more swiftly next year, from next spring, when it could start to enter in the single digit range, once the effect of this year's huge household gas and electricity price hike and fuel price increases move out from the base. We have some extra shock next August, September, when the current gas and electricity freeze for household expires. We assume that there will be some further hike, but who knows? But overall, we think that we are at least close to the peak of inflation. If not, we are already at the peak. We are aware that the central bank just released after its decision view that still this year they expect some upward movement in inflation, probably from food prices, which cannot be ruled out. Nevertheless, we don't think, and to our understanding, even the central bank does not communicate that they expect substantial increase from now on. And here I would highlight one further momentum that which is a good news actually from the Romanian inflation point of view, that although your headline inflation is above 15%, but a more core like inflation, which excludes food, energy, alcohol, tobacco, which is quickly affected by government measures, inflation is close to 6-7% this core inflation, while in a lot of other countries it's like 15 or even more. So this means that once the effect of these volatile items like food and energy will turn back, which is usually happening, then there's no need to have a very persistently high inflation in Romania. And to our understanding, financial markets have started already to to price this this story. On this chart, you can see the 3 months ROBOR and the central bank policy rate. And when, you know, inflation data, like from last autumn, has started to surprise sharply on the upside, but you could have observed that the interbank rate, the 3 months ROBOR rate, was rushing always ahead of the policy rate. And you might remember that we even mentioned that we think that given what market prices, the central bank might be a bit lagging behind, but by now this gap seems to gradually close. So the ROBOR do not increase anymore, while the central bank kept rate hikes, and we expect at least one further hike. And from another point of view, this again shows that the market also prices that we cannot be very far from the peak of the interest rate hike. So in this chart, you can see the yield curve where the within year parts are put together from the interbank rates and the long-term part from the government bond rates. And this curve used to be actually quite steep a few months ago, while by now it's relatively flat, which also shows that markets do not expect that the interest rate level should increase much further. Naturally, it's under the assumption of what markets price now for the US or the Eurozone rate. If that turns out completely differently, that can affect Romania as well. And certainly, probably these times risk are to the upside, so the risks point toward a higher rate than we say. But at least now we observe the first momentum that that it can occur that we are close to the peak of the interest rate hikes. And just one slide at the end that Gergely started partly mention is that in the banking sector, to higher interest rates and due to lower real income of households, credit market have started to react. Here you can see the year-on-year credit growth in corporate, housing and consumer loans, and you can see that although from relatively high levels, or with the company loans, I would say especially high levels, we can already observe a slowdown, and then even relatively sharp slowdown in housing loans. And we expect this trend to continue for the rest of this year and next year, given the slowdown in economic activity. So overall, just to sum up, I would highlight again our main messages, which was already presented by Gerge. We expect GDP growth to slow as Romania tries to adapt to high energy prices and the Eurozone stagnation, if not recession. Inflation could be close to peak. The central bank could hike the rate to around 7% in November, and probably there's a chance that they will stop there or maybe hike slightly more, but not much. We have a resumed fiscal consolidation, but with the high energy prices, the twin deficit problem of Romania will improve very slowly. And we see already a slowdown in the banking market due to a slowdown in economic activity and the expected slowdown and higher rates. And we expect for next year this trend to continue. So thank you very much. This was from my side.
Thank you, Mihaly. That was very interesting. That was actually very in-depth. But now we have some questions from our audience. If you're ready to answer, the first one would be about the FX between euro and the dollar. What's the trend there on the exchange rate?
Well, actually, in the let's say last few quarters, the dollar strengthened a lot. And this has a few reasons. First, with risk aversion on the rise, usually investors are going for the dollar. That's a very important factor. Second, interest rates will be hiked to a higher level in the US, and their current level is higher in the US than in the Eurozone. That's also a factor which supports the dollar. And the third factor is that the war and the energy crisis affects the European economy much stronger. And while the US is a net exporter of energy, this is not the case in the Eurozone, where something like close to two-thirds of all energy consumption or all energy use, that's imported, and a significant part of that energy is coming from Russia. And with higher prices, the external balance of Europe is deteriorating, and while it showed a significant surplus not so long ago, now it's a current account deficit, and it's widening. And the deterioration in the external position means that on the let's say that the FX market, the supply of euro is on the rise, and that put pressure on the exchange rate. So just like what's happening, for example, in Hungary and in many other emerging economies, importing a lot of energy. So these terms of trade shock means that, let's say, that the fair value of the euro against the dollar is weaker. And this three factor put a lot of pressure on the exchange rate. Looking ahead, what can be expected? I think that on the short run, the dollar could appreciate more. So because we are still in the phase when central bank aren't hiking rates, investors are avoiding risky assets, and this supports the dollar. But on the middle run, we expect gas prices to moderate, and the pressure on the euro could decrease as well. So maybe the next quarter or the next two quarters could bring further dollar appreciation. But on the middle run, we would expect, let's say, on a 1.5-2 year horizon, to euro regain more strength and to the euro dollar to go above parity. But as I told you, this is not the story of this month or the next, but that is what we expect on the middle run.
All right, then. One other thank you again for all these explanations. One other questions from our audience: what are the main drivers of better Romanian GDP evolution in 2023 as compared with the EU average? Meaning, like, what would help Romania GDP to perform better in 2023 as compared to the European average. Yeah.
Okay, so in one sentence, but I will detail it in a few more, the potential growth of Romania as a catching up country is higher than that of the Eurozone. That's the starting point. Like Eurozone, if you make a trend calculation for its growth rate, it's 1-1.5% growth it can produce in the medium term. While for Romania, it's like at least 3%, if not 3.5%. The reason for the higher potential growth, one effect is investment. The other effect is, and partly related to this, financial deepening, which means that, you know, economic actors and also households still have room to take on more loans, while in the Eurozone you have a major market. And it's also true that you import technology from abroad, and from this you have a catch-up process. This is what happens on the average. In the short term, like from year to year, this does it should not necessarily happen that Romania is growing more every year than the Eurozone, but probably it has been the trend for decades already. And even if you look at the 2020 fallback in Romanian activity, which was at the latest revised data, I think it's minus 3.6, while for the Eurozone, it was like minus 6 point something. So even in that year it occurred. The general point is that you have a strong tendency for household to consume. You receive lots of EU funds, which helps investments even in that time. And it's also true that what we discussed, that the terms of trade shock, like the negative shock from energy prices for Romania is smaller than for even the Eurozone. So you are far below European average in net energy imports. And because your energy import bill doesn't increase to that much, in relative terms, you are better off. So, and finally, just one further point I would also like to make, that as long as we are right and inflation is already close to peak and the interest rate is not hiked further by significant percentage points, the tightening effect of monetary policy could gradually fade, which is also helpful. Why, if you remember what we presented on the Eurozone, in their case, monetary tightening is supposed to continue further at least for 1 year. So they are far away from where they are supposed to be with the peak interest rate. So overall, like I would attribute the relatively good performance of Romania to the above factors.
Thank you, Mihaly. And if I may, another one. Well, you are saying about the households being able to contract even more, maybe credit. But do you have an estimation, let's say, on what's the effect on the population budget or appetite for spending for the next month, let's say up until the end of the year? Is the population still inclined to consume, or are they, it's clear that they are stopping spending and saving?
I don't know, maybe I will say a few sentences and if others want to continue. So from the retail sales data, actually up to August, we see some slowdown, but the consumers are relatively still eager to consume, somewhat slower pace than before, but you don't see a very sharp correction. On the other hand, if you look at confidence indicators, they are falling more. So probably worse to come. This is also in our forecast. And also what we presented in the last slide, we can see that both the housing loan and consumer loan activity is weakening. So all this points to gradually declining sentiment to spend from the household side.
If I may just add something to that, so the consumption maybe in terms of nominal values are still increasing, but the content, so how much products we can get for this money, it's month by month it's declining. So I think it's important to understand that the inflation is really having an impact of the total spend. So we have to spend more to getting less.
Okay then. And there's still appetite for spending, let's see. But what about the ones that want to save? What are the opportunities at hand? What saving solutions should we consider now?
How we see in our bank that definitely there is an appetite for people to say. Of course, there are different segments and they behaving differently, but we see then the increasing savings appetite for certain segments, especially private individuals, of course. What we also see that the interest rates are increasing, I would say, day by day. So actually, the 7-8% rate is really available in our bank as well. So this also supports the saving attitude and behavior. And what we see that maybe more and more people are thinking about to even invest for longer term, because if we consider that what Gergely and Mihai was saying, that probably the rates, we see the top of the rates, then probably for long term to taking these rates, it's a good deal.
So we should make the most of it, these rates now, and benefit while we can.
We always say that, do it gradually, so don't put all your money, but probably it's time to invest for longer. So not instead of 3 months, a year, not all your money, but a part of it. And also, the vendor rate starts to lower, then it's also time for the stock market. I'm not saying now, but maybe it's not really far away.
All right. And if I may, one last question from the audience. We were talking about deposit rates. Do you have an estimation, let's say, for the end of 2022? Where they could be above 9%, maybe?
Could it reach there? So we are really, I hope that we are really close to the top. So maybe somewhere between 8 and 9, hopefully not reaching the 9, but this is probably only my wishful thinking.
All right then. If there are no more questions from the audience, maybe we'll wait, let's say, 1 more minute. If there are no more questions from the audience, let's see. No, waiting some more. In the meantime, thank you all for the very interesting info. Quite a lot of info to follow and to be aware of. Thank you for you, our presenters today, and the audience for attending this event. Also, we hope these insights will be helpful for you, and you'll better navigate the upcoming events and economic developments. And stay in touch, stay informed, stay on top of it. Call us if you need information, if you need counseling, and together we'll get over this this period. So have a great day. Thank you for your participation, and let's see each other again next time.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.